Czyli Tatum 368, Tatum 368 multiply by 4. That should give us this. So we have 53, 4, 2, 7, 4, 7, 2. 53, 4, 7, 2. Let me be sure it's there. 53, 4, 7, 2. Okay, that's the correct figure. Now, for this information, I don't know yet whether this transaction has been accounted for or not, but I actually know it has not been accounted for. And why is that? Because I can't see that figure evidenced in this section here. This is not it. So let's read further and know. So they say cash consideration of this figure. That is what I just highlighted earlier for the shares acquired. So the cash consideration has been accounted for. The parent company will pay a further 0.50 pound per or 0.5 pound per shares acquired at 31st December 2019. 31st December 2019 is of course 2 years time, starting from the acquisition date. So it means that's a deferred consideration. Power PLC has a cost of capital of 8%. And has only recorded the cash consideration. That is the reason why we have seen the cash consideration information, because it has only recorded it in the accounts. Discount rate factor at 8%, the question has given it to us, so we don't have to bring tease our head in getting that figure. Share price at the date of acquisition has been given, and we have utilized that information already. So I'm going to show you the double entry for the cash consideration, though it has been accounted for, just for knowledge sake. So I'll call this my workings 2, and I call it the cash consideration. Basically we're debiting investment, and the figure we have for it is 27,900, and we credit cash. So I don't have to still credit cash again. I'm only just showing you, for knowledge sake, the double entry implication. For workings 3 is a deferred consideration. For deferred consideration, the first thing we want to do is to determine the future consideration. Now the future consideration would be, again, 80% of 25065 multiply by 0.5, and that will give us our future consideration. So 0.8 times 25065 multiply by 0.5, and that gives us 10,026. So this is our future consideration. But what we are going to debit to investment is the present value of the future consideration, which is 10,026, open bracket, or let me just say multiply by, since the question has given us the information, 0.926, and that gives us, multiply by 0.926, that gives us 9284, approximately 9284. We're going to debit the profit or loss respect to finance cost, or the group, the statement of financial position in respect to the group retained earnings, and that will be the PV of the future consideration, which is 9284, multiplied by the cost of capital, which is 8% in this case. So 9284 multiplied by 0.08, that gives us 743 approximately. 3. And we credit the deferred consideration. Deferred consideration. We just have 1 year to go. So current liability with the addition of these two figures. And that will be 74243 plus 9284. And that gives us 9284. That's supposed to be correct. Okay, just to cross check my figures, we have 10,000. We're taking 80% of the figure. Okay, 0.8 multiplied by 25,065. Okay, and multiply by 0.5. Okay, that's correct. Multiply by 0.926. And that gives us these figures correct. So what we have here, multiply by 0.08473. Okay, we're on the right track. Okay, just to be sure. Okay, so we have 9284 plus 743, and that gives us this figure. Of course, which is just an approximate of the figure. So we have 10,026 back, which is an approximate like we've done earlier. So, okay, now moving forward, what do we have next? We have not accounted for the deferred consideration. We have not accounted for the share for share exchange. So we need to account for them right now. So we have 13,368. That will go to the share capital section. So probably I should use a different marker so that whatever I'm bringing in will be different. 13,368. Okay, so we could just see something I'm bringing in. So we have 27,842 plus 13,368, and that gives us 41,210. Okay, we have a share premium, so let me bring it down here. Share premium account, and the share premium accounts are what we've done in the workings there. 53,472. Okay, so we have it to be 53,472. So bringing that figure there. Okay, after that, that's for the share for share. Accounted for these two information. This has already been accounted for, so I don't need to account for it again. For the this, we have 743 will go to the profit or loss. So here I don't have to put the zero. So 743 coming to the profit or loss. Okay, after that I have a deferred consideration of 10,026. So we have here deferred consideration, and that will be 10,026. Okay, so we've accounted for all the information, both the share for share and the deferred consideration, although I'm still going to take this information to the group within earnings. Now, leaving that aside, we would be moving to the next information. Now, what's the next information? Here they said Power PLC also acquired the 30% of the voting shares of Hulk Limited on 1st of January 2018, paying a cash consideration of this figure. This is also in the financial position. Hulk Limited income statement show a net profit after tax. A net profit after tax of this figure. For the 12-month period to 31st December 2018, both companies have the same accounting year end. Of course, starting January, ending December, so it's the same accounting year end. Okay, so we are going to do the equity accounting, which is investment in associate in this case. And that takes us back to the group structure quickly. So we have here, it's acquiring all. And it's acquired 30%. Now I'm going to do another note here, and I'm going to call it note 2 for her investment in associate. Okay, and since we have our investment in associate, the purchase consideration has been given already. So we have purchase consideration. And the figure for the purchase consideration is 34,650. We have the share of profits. And the share of profit there, there it will be 4,750. 4,750 multiplied by 30%. So 4,750 multiplied by 0.3. 1425, and this gives us plus 36,075. So we have our investment in associate figure already, so we are going to make use of it and recognize it. 36,075. So associate here we have 36,075, bringing in the figure. We've done the working for that already. Okay, now moving back to the question. So we could see we have utilized all the information we have in the first paragraph here. Now it's time to move down to the next information. Now the next information usually for me would be the fair value of the net assets. So I'm going to just create another note, calling it my note 3. Note 3, fair value of net assets for SAL. And we have the acquisition dates. We have the reporting dates. And we have the post acquisition profit or loss. Now the share capital will always be constant both at the acquisition date and the reporting date, and we have that to be 25065. Of course, that figure we utilize it a lot, 25065, in our computations. So 25065. Now what comes next? Of course, what comes next is the retained earnings, and because there is no revaluation here, so the retained earnings given here at the reporting date is 9741. So we have 9 retained earnings, 9741. Okay, now after that, we need the retained earnings at the date of acquisition. So since the question has given us profit for the year, I think I should just come down here to do workings on retained earnings of SAL. And we have retained earnings at the reporting date, which is 9741. Then we need our profit after tax to subtract or profit for the year. And the profit for the year here is 5,650. 5655. Deducting this will give us our retained earnings at the acquisition date. So we have 9741 minus 5655. And that gives us 4086. So we bring it back here, 4086 as the retained earnings at the date of acquisition. Okay. Now, these informations are always already in the financial statement, and we have utilized that information. So let's go to that additional information. So in the next notes here, it says the fair value exercise conducted at the date of acquisition shows the following changes to sales statement of all sales non-current assets. Okay, so the first says property had a fair value of 15 million and a book value of 10 million. So the difference between these two was 5 million, deemed to have a remaining useful life of 25 years. The depreciation is calculated on a straight line basis. So we're going to also do working for that. Working on fair value on all on properties. So the fair value at acquisition will be 15 minus 10,000, and that will give us 5,000. Because the excess that we need, depreciation is 5,000. Divide by 25. Just to be sure, it's for life, of course. So we have 5,000 divide by 25, and that gives us 200. And this gives us 4,800 as the fair value at the reporting date. Therefore, we have fair value adjustment, and we have property at acquisition is 5,000 and at reporting is 4,800. The 4,800, we are bringing it to the PPE section. So we have here plus 4,800. Of course, depreciation, let's be sure if the question tells us where to take it to. And the question was silent as to where depreciation would go to. So I'm going to take depreciation to cost of sales section. Plus 200, taking depreciation to cost of sales. Okay, then they said fair value of land was 3 million above the book value. Fair value of land was 3 million above the book value. Of course, this is also at the date of acquisition. So I'm just going to come here to add this 3 million here and do the other adjustment in the net asset section. So in the net asset section here, I'm going to have land, 3 million at acquisition, and 3 million at reporting. Nothing has actually changed. That's what we have. So we are done with note one, moving to note two. The fair value exercise conducted at the reporting date, which is like a revaluation exercise by Power PLC, showed that the property mentioned above has an upward increase in its value by what? 1 million. So there's a further increase. So this is more like a revaluation gain on land. Or is it on property? Let me be sure. On properties. On properties. And we don't have anything at acquisition, but we have 1 million at the reporting date. And that takes us again back to the current, non-current asset section on PPE. We have plus 1,000 again. And under our other comprehensive income, I'm just going to call, say, plus 1,000 here. Okay, or rather I should just do gain valuation of property and I have 1,000. This is going to be 5063. Okay, so we can leave that and move forward. Okay, so that's done with that. Note 3. Pal, which is a parent, sold goods to the subsidiary Sal, worth 3 million intra-group transaction during the year. For intra-group transaction, we're expected to eliminate all intra-group transactions. Now, in as much as I know we are going to do that, I'm going to immediately call this my note 4. I think my fair value of net assets should be my note 3. Okay. So my note 4, I'm going to have goodwill here for sale and the purchase consideration. We have share for share and the share for share figure, you can bring it quickly, 66840. We have cash consideration, and cash consideration we have it to 27,900, and we have the deferred consideration. And the deferred consideration we have the figure to be 9248. Of course, the fair value of the non-controlling interest would come, which would be the fair value of the business. Then we deduct the fair value of the net assets at the acquisition date, which of course other workings will come suit, but let me call this my note 5, which is a non-controlling interest, and I will still have the fair value of NCI coming here, so I'm going to lose some little bit of space again. And I have my note 6, which is the group retained earnings. And here the parent retained earnings will come. Parent retained earnings. Can quickly pick that information since it's not going to be too far. And that's 80,058. Okay, so we have 80,058. Okay, and then we have workings. So the first working in here, because we have so many workings, we have intra-group sales according to that question. And like I said, we are eliminating all intra-group sales. Therefore, we are debiting revenue with 3 million and we are crediting our costs of sales. 3 million. Why we are doing this is because the parent has sold, so you recognize revenue. The subsidiary has purchased, definitely recognize purchase in its cost of sales, so we eliminate the 3 million from the good side. This takes us to the beginning. So we have here minus 3. Okay, that's that for that question, for that statement. Okay, coming back to the question, now says PAL PLC made a markup on cost of 25% on all these sales. So later you check one of my videos, I'll be talking about conversions of margin to markup and markup to margin. At the reporting year end, 40% of the goods still remains in inventory of SAL. Therefore, this gives rise to provisions for unrealized profits. This gives rise to provisions for unrealized profits. So we have workings 2, provisions for unrealized profits. Call this PURP. Now, The provisions for unrealized profits, remember they sold 3,000 times 40%, which is what is left in inventory. And that should be also 1,2, but accuracy, let's just use a calculator. 1,2 multiply by 25/125. Multiply by 25 divided by 125, and that gives us 240. So the unrealized profit is 240, and because it is PAL selling to SAL, I'm going to debit the group retained earnings with the 240, credit inventory with the 240. And we are also going to add to the cost of sales. And we are also going to add to the cost of sales. So we have here deferred, just don't want to forget, consideration, finance cost. Deferred consideration, finance cost. The figure, we have it somewhere up there, let's just sort it out. 743. So we have it 743. Then we have provisions for unrealized profits from inventory. And we have it with 240. Then we have share of profits of associates. I wouldn't want to forget that information. I'm almost forgetting it already. And the share profit of associates is 1,425.